IVM.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast supported by Pragati, a flagship media initiative of the Takshashila Institution. We're a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like to bring a fresh perspective to Indian affairs and an Indian perspective to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hi, and welcome to another episode of All Things Policy. I'm Harshit Kukreja, and I am a research analyst with the Health and Life Sciences program at Takshashila Institution. Today, we are going to walk you through the evolution of public health via storytelling. Before I introduce you to my guest for the day, I would like to inform you that the applications for JCPP and PGP are now open. The cohort for both the program begins on 15 January of the next year, and last date to register is 8 January. We have Mehak Nirkani with us today. She manages the Graduate Certificate Program of Health and Life Sciences at the Takshashila Institution. Hi, Mehak. How are you doing today?
Hey, I'm doing great. So you and I have been planning to do this podcast on the history of public health via different stories for long, and it's been long delayed. So now that it's finally happening, I'm happy. All good in the hood.
Great. So let us get you started. Till quite recently, public health did not exist at this scale. There were no large-scale community programs targeted towards the health of the population. We will take you through how public health evolved to its present form. We will start with the prehistoric times.
Yeah. So, we know that tens of thousands of years ago, humans were actually hunters. They were gatherers. And we also know that they had a shorter lifespan, the life expectancy wasn't very high. But one needs to understand that the shorter lifespan of people living back then cannot only be accounted to epidemics, infections, but a lot of studies show that the primary problem at that point was that they couldn't find enough food to eat. And they lived and traveled in very small groups, and they hunted and foraged for food. So it was only when agriculture started and when there was a shift from hunter-gatherer mode of living to an agricultural model, people at that point of time had a more secure supply of food and they had better nutrition to fulfill their needs. But however, what also happened with it was that the domesticated animals also came along with it. And there was not only food and labor, there was also a sudden increment or sudden carrying away of diseases which got transmitted to humans. And we know that at that point of time, people were just dependent on probably one or two crops for their survival, and their balanced diet wasn't ticking off correctly. And people started to live in larger groups in the very same place, and they were not used to it, and that actually started the transmission of diseases, and that is when public health began.
Interesting. Meg, so can you tell us more about the more recent advances? I've heard the Romans were pioneers of the modern sanitation system.
First of all, Romans are also not recent advances. It's very old, but yeah, you were right. A lot of people say that the first traces of underground sewage as we were in the city can be given to the people of Rome, and it dates back around to 500 BC. At that point of time, Romans actually realized that there was a accumulation of human waste, and that was the cause of large spread of diseases, and that is how they started to build city-states in the area which had proper underground sewers, and that was actually copied in most of the cities afterwards. So that was one of the initial public health measure which was taken. We now talk about all of these things, why proper sewage, it's important, but we also need to realize that several centuries ago actually realized the importance of it, and public health is not something which came into being today. It dates back a very, very, very long time ago.
Oh, so we can thank the Romans for our modern plumbing system.
We can thank the Romans for a lot of other things as well.
So, coming to the more recent times, With the COVID-19 pandemic, everybody knows about quarantine and isolation. Can you tell us more about how we developed an understanding of these measures and started using them?
Yeah, so now if you ask any child what quarantine is, they would probably know about it. But 2 years before now, a lot of people who aren't into the field of medicine or public health wouldn't understand the basic definition of quarantining. But that does not account for the fact that quarantine was not something which was developed now during the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. It is a public health measure which dates back to the 14th century when actually the Black Death happened in Italy and the rest of the Europe. So quarantine actually means, if we talk about the literal definition, actually means secluding one person which has the potential to infect others. And that is how now we talk about probably a 14 or 17 day period. But initially quarantine meant proper 40 day period. And when there was a lot of traveling happening in 14th century and people started to move from one place to another. And that is how when the Black Death started to happen, travelers and people from across the globe, which were potentially being exposed to several diseases, were isolated for a period of time so that the population and the other people living in the area don't get infected. This practice was actually continued across several epidemics, several outbreaks across the globe for a very, very long period of time. And it also happened in the 19th and the 20th century. So when almost two decades ago, when SARS hit almost all parts of the world, it was followed then also. Canada was one of the biggest countries which practiced quarantine on a very, very large level. And now when we have the ongoing pandemic, we know how important quarantining is, how important distancing is. And so it's not a very, very new phenomenon. It's just that people from all parts of the globe are actually going through the same thing. And that is how they know about all of these things happening. But we also need to understand that these small public health measures were in some parts of the city happening at different points of time.
An interesting take. So we have basically used these same old public health measures from a long time.
Their formations, they might have evolved across a period of time. But yeah, the formation dates back many, many centuries ago.
So Meg, have you heard about John Pringle and how he incorrectly attributed typhus to filth? But he did reduce the incidence. Can you tell us more about him?
Yeah. So John Pringle was basically a physician. And if I'm not wrong, he was a Scottish physician who was serving the British forces around the time 1740s. Then at that point of time, there was a war of Austrian succession. And John Physician was actually with the soldiers at that point in time. And so he did an extensive study. And he also talked about jail fever, which was very, very common among soldiers and prisoners in jail. And Pringle incorrectly believed and also said that the typhus or the black fever was actually caused by filth, but that was later proved to be wrong. It is actually caused by a small bacterium, and that is how the bacterium multiplies, and if not treated on time, it was fatal and people were dying. But keeping that story aside, he actually brought that out into light, and he wrote this piece, and it was published in 1752, which is called Observations on the Diseases of the Army, and in which he proposed a number of measures aimed at improving the health of soldiers, improvements in hospital ventilation and camp sanitation. He also, one of the most important things that he focused was on drainage, proper drainage system, proper sanitation system, adequate facilities of water, and latrines at that point in time. So though in some aspects he was wrong regarding the origin or regarding the reason of typhus or black fever, jail fever, but he actually brought that picture into light. And that is how we can account him at that point in time that he did really help people to start thinking about these things. And if I would just want to add that a lot of people wouldn't know this, but Pringle was the one who actually coined the term influenza. So now we talk about it, so we can give the credit to him as well.
So Pringle seems like a very interesting man who helped us get a lot of concepts into light, which we are still using today, even though he incorrectly attributed typhus to filth. But his measures helped reduce the incidence a lot. So we learned from Pringle about observational studies. Can you tell us about the first controlled clinical trials?
So now you have raised a very good point. So the first incidence of observational studies and the first controlled clinical trials actually happened around the same point in time. It was only in 1740s when James Lind, who was himself a physician, again a physician, who conducted a controlled clinical trial, and which is actually called the first controlled clinical trial of the modern era. So during the late 1740s, he observed that a lot of people who were sailors actually suffered from scurvy. He saw that they had putrid gums, they had spots, and their knees were getting weak. And that is how he wanted to find a reason and a cure for that. So somewhere around 1747, he started doing this. He selected these 12 patients who were on board, who were sailors and who had scurvy. So he tried different things and he divided them into groups of two or three and started giving them different things. Like, for example, to two people, he would give oranges. To two people, he would give lemon. And to two people, he would just give water, gruel with sweetened with sugar in the morning and something later in the evening. And he observed it for a period of few days. And he realized that two of the patients who actually had oranges and lemons suddenly showed visible good effect in just a period of 4 or 5 days, and they could actually return to their duties immediately after that. And then he also followed up, but at that point of time, oranges and lemons were not very cheap. They were actually very expensive, so he wasn't very sure about the result. But later it was so he did not recommend it, but later British Navy, somewhere around eventually 50 years down the line, the lemon juice was made a compulsory part of a seafarer's diet. And this was soon replaced again by lime juice because it is much cheaper. But keeping that aside, we can say that it was because of the study done by James Lind that we got to know the treatment of scurvy and how to help sailors when they're on board.
Oh, so James Scurvy also had to take monetary considerations for recommending scientific measures, not too different from what we have to do today, obviously. So we talked about controlled studies. Why don't we jump to the Industrial Revolution? With the Industrial Revolution came the problems of overcrowding, poor sanitation, air pollution. Mehak, can you elaborate a little on how public health was managed during these new change times with the new problems?
More than management, I would want to focus on what actually happened during Industrial Revolution. So there was an explosion in population growth. We know machines were rolling in. The development was happening at a much higher and much faster rate, which nobody actually ever thought about. And so a lot of people thought that this is going to be nice, but nobody actually realized that this mass migration and this expansion of population and this explosive growth of cities would also bring along severe public health issues. And so if you see that at that point in time, these cities were not properly constructed. They were constructed for a limited population, but then there was a sudden migration from rural places to urban regions. And so the population density increased a lot. So we know that the working class already had were working hours. They had to work in extreme harsh conditions. They were living with many risks and dangers. They were living in cramped areas which had no proper ventilation, no drainage. And add to that, we know that this toxic exposure at that point in time also affected their mental health. So consequently, what happened is progress, which is called out to be one of the biggest chains of development which have happened. One also need to consider that at that point in time, all of this brought a whole new set of health problems that were unprecedented and that were widespread in Europe and America. Of course, further decades down the line, several health measures were taken, and we know that a lot of treaties were signed, things were done. But one also needs to understand that everything has an opportunity cost to it if you're doing something at a much higher and faster rate in terms of development. There will be consequences to health, especially people who are vulnerable, who do not have proper housing and economic conditions to live.
So the Industrial Revolution brought the same problems we are facing nowadays, but the Western countries faced them 100 years ago, and we are still trying to mitigate and solve these problems right now. We'll do. 300
years ago.
So thanks, Mehak. Before moving ahead, we'll take a short break. See you guys on the other side.
Hey, it's been another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. On the Wire Talks, it's all about the Beatles. Oliver Kratzky, author and freelance editor who has closely worked with the famous band in the past, tells Siddharth why they're so loved even today. On All Things Policy, the folks at the Takshashila Institute discuss Russia's motives, why it's insecure with the G2, and the logic behind its growing alliance with China. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam is joined by Nikhil Agarwal. He is the co-founder and CEO of Grip Invest, and they discuss the working of lease and inventory finance in India. The Simplified Gang speaks to author Suman Srivastava about her new book, Don't Beg, Inspire. And on the Filter Coffee podcast, Surya Swapna, founder of Kathavani, talks to Karthik about mythological storytelling for children. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any of our other shows for that matter, please do tell a friend. Go check out our YouTube channels. We go live on a whole bunch of different things. We have a number of different channels. You can find them on ivmpodcast.com/YouTube. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors this week: Cred, Bank of Baroda, CoinSwitch Kuber, Intel, and Oxfam India. Thank you for making this possible.
Hi guys, we are back. So Mehak, can you tell us more about Jon Snow and his contribution to the field?
Everybody knows Jon Snow killed the Queen.
Not that Jon Snow. His lesser known namesake, Jon Snow, the public health one.
So the story by Jon Snow is actually very, very popular because it became a huge act of vandalism. But I'll say it for people who don't know, that the actual history of modern public health in London began with an act of vandalism. Somebody named Jon Snow actually broke the handle of a water pump and carried it away. And it was in Broad Street in London where there was an outbreak of cholera. So cholera was spreading across all those concentric circles and affecting a very large number of people. So Jon Snow somehow mapped out the outbreak and how was it spreading, and then found out that the center of the circle was a water pump, which was actually resulting in bad, poor quality of water. And because of contamination with sewage, and this was causing cholera and it was affecting the health of people. So Jon Snow broke the handle of the pump and the outbreak genuinely ceased at that point in time. So it was an important measure. We again realized how important clean water is for efficient public health. And it was then linked to sanitation and good quality of water, and then ultimately to better and effective and efficient public health.
You know, Jon Snow also did a very good contribution to London. There's a pub right at the place where he removed the handle. I don't know if it is still operational or not, but I think there is.
So, I wasn't aware of it. The books don't teach us that.
The books often leave good things out of their text.
True.
Moving on, what about colonization? How did it affect the field?
Yeah, so that's a very, very good question, actually, because colonization did play a huge part in the evolution of public health. So before colonization happened, everybody was concerned and trying to devise these strategies for prevention and control of diseases in their own countries. They wanted to save lives of the people of their own nation. However, this knowledge and practice started to spread across the borders, and the applications tried to begin in different countries when colonization happened. We need to know that it wasn't earlier because that the people did care about the residents of the other nation. Initially, this was just a matter of actually curiosity, but then it actually became a compulsion because these people who worked for the colonizers, they had to protect these people because now their well-being was very, very, very important for their economic benefit. So the health of the people from the countries they were colonizing became a very important matter for them for bettering economic resources for their own country. And there's also another term which we call as geographic pathology, which actually was termed in the 19th century. So it was how the international people were studying that the international comparisons of disease patterns were different from one country to another country. And this, the study of this was called geographic pathology. And this actually is known as the basis of modern epidemiology. So colonizers taking care of the health of the people of the country they were colonizing was important because of two reasons. One, curiosity, they wanted to study and they wanted to know how diseases spread in probably the poorer parts of the world. And second, they had to take care of their own economic generating sources.
So as long as their economy was protected, they did not care about us. And at the moment they started getting infected and their support, whoever was contributing into their treasury was affected, they were now concerned about the diseases of our countries.
Definitely. So we know that Britishers genuinely didn't care about the number of people who died in India during the plague. But for them, the study was important, and they actually started taking care of people later because they know that they have to face huge losses because they had limited number of men. Colonization did play a huge part in the evolution of public health. It is only because of colonization that the borders were merged and the studies and the knowledge also, the application also moved from one territory to another territory.
Yeah, so this is something similar is also observed in medical research studies of nowadays. All the good journals and all the good focus is currently on the journals which are based in Western countries. It is slowly moving towards us. The focus is slowly moving towards the developing countries and the underdeveloped countries.
Mm-hmm.
But it will take some time. Yeah. So,
definitely.
Yeah, the Rockefeller Foundation. The Rockefeller Foundation has played a huge role in this field. They gave a grant to William H. Wells, who established the first proper school of public health, the John Hopkins School of Hygiene and Public Health, which has now been renamed to the Bloomberg School. Can you tell us that story?
Yeah, so like you're right that the first public health school in the world officially it's called the John Hopkins School of Hygiene and Public Health, and now it's called the Bloomberg School. So it was somewhere around 1915 when you correctly named the person, somebody called William H. Welch. He came out with a report called the Welch Rose Report. So the report was actually a seminal justification and blueprint for the need of schools of public health in the country. And Welch, who was the primary author, he crafted this justification and description of this institute. And just 1 year later, he actually founded the Hopkins School of Hygiene and Public Health. And it was after that he published this report that led to the establishments of a lot of public health schools in the United States of America and even in Europe. Although Europe had some informal schools of public health, but it was actually after this report that the institutions were being set up, which started to impart knowledge regarding public health and training. And soon after, many countries followed that.
Yeah. So some reports do lead to something good. Yeah. So jumping to the last 50 years, how have those been for public health? What have been the major landmarks we have achieved?
So in the past 50 years, we have had seen a lot of assemblies, a lot of commissions, one being the World Health Assembly, which happened in 1977. There was a resolution for health, for all of which ultimately resulted in the Alma-Ata Declaration, which also emphasized the importance of primary health services. And 10 years after that, it was in 1987 when we had the Brundtland Commission, and it was decided that that this whole area of environment sustainability for health is also needed. And it was also actually a competent, and a lot of many countries followed that. Then we know that if I'm not wrong, I think it was in 1993 when World Development Report came out, and then there was then a question on whether health would automatically benefit from economic development, or investments in health also were needed for accelerated economic development. And that conversation began in terms of this bi-directional relationship in the World Development Report of 1993, that is investing in health. And then, of course, everybody knows that we had MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals in 2000, and recognizing that health and development are integrally related. So at least three direct health-related goals were accommodated in MDGs of 2000, which were adopted by the United Nations. And following that, in 2015, we had the Sustainable Development Goals, where there is a setup that there is a set relationship between sustainability and public health. So if you say that before 50 years, we had seen an evolution from initial interest in tropical medicine as a part of colonization, then to international health in high-income countries. And then there was these developed countries looking at problems in middle or low-income countries. But I would say what has immensely changed in past 10 years is that we are now moving to a new phase where global health activities, including research and training, people emphasizing that it should be led by people from the low and middle income countries. And we also recognize that even as these transitions are taking place in nature of leadership of global public health, which is becoming much more of a shared enterprise with low and middle income countries also emerging as leaders, public health itself has become a much broader discipline, both in terms of learning and in terms of practice.
So yeah, we have been seeing a shift in the public health domain and also an expanding of our understanding the scope of the field and looking at problems, health problems from a viewpoint of a population. So thanks, Mehak. Do you have any concluding remarks?
I not like concluding remarks, but I just want to highlight one point that when one needs to study public health, we need to understand that basic fact that it's a very, very broad discipline, and it unifies a lot of different fields, which includes like humanities, which includes social sciences, environment and life sciences and management, and there is planetary health, there is data management and a lot of other things. So it's for people who are working, people who are studying, people who are researching, and most importantly, people who are governing. One needs to understand public health from a variety of domains, otherwise we'll keep failing.
Thank you, Meg, so much for walking us through the history of public health through these amazing theories. Thank you, listeners. And for more episodes relating to policy, stay tuned for the next episode of All Things Policy.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle, @TakshashilaInst, or our website, takshashila.org.in.
Working Monday to Friday, glued to your chair, making you feel dull? Worry not. Get your 5-minute weekly dose of travel around the world with Postcards from Nowhere. Join me every Thursday as I explore the strange, obscure, and fascinating parts of the world and bring out facets of travel you may not have thought of before. You can find us on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you get your podcast from.
Are you looking for finance products and services that can enhance your personal finance experience? Are you looking for a space to talk about your financial product or service? And are you looking for a crisp talk show where the conversation is all about money? Well, your search ends here. Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta and I'm host of the Paisa Paisa podcast, and I invite you for the conversation about your personal finance on each Monday on the IVM podcast app or the website or on any podcast streaming platforms. See you folks.